Good morning. All right, on our announcements today, please note that the office will be closed tomorrow, and Tuesday we start preschool. So those of you who have signed up to help with the Boohoo breakfast, please be here around 8 to 8:30. The other thing with preschool is last year we had prayer buddies. So people signed up, they were given a preschooler to pray for through the year and to bring a few gifts to kind of draw that connection between the church and the preschool. So if you would like to be a prayer buddy this year, we have about 18 preschoolers. And I will give you a list with some things about them, things they like, when their birthday is, and some important dates to maybe drop off a card or a little gift or some candy, just something to kind of let them know that the church is thinking about them and praying for them. So if you would like to do that, shoot me an email or let me know after the service. On Wednesday at 7, we start Christmas choir rehearsal. That will be in the sanctuary. Please wear a mask. And then next Sunday is family game night. And next Wednesday is the last day to sign up for the Holiday World trip. At the bottom, you'll see that it is budget time. So if you're a budget holder or you would like to request a new budget, please let both Rhonda and Laura know. So if you're going to email, email both of them at the same time. Lifeline, what we need is on the back. That's coming up in 2 weekends. Bread, cereal, soup, cheese slices, shampoo, brownie mix, and salad dressings for a salad. And now, most importantly, today is both Nancy Counselor and Dean Osier's birthday. Miss Dean is 94 today. Join me in our call to worship. It's from Psalms 8. Yahweh, our sovereign God, your glory streams from the heavens above, filling the earth with the majesty of your name. People everywhere see your splendor. You have built a stronghold by the songs of children. Strength rises up with the chorus of infants. This kind of praise has power to shut Satan's mouth. Childlike worship will silence the madness of those who oppose you. Yahweh, our sovereign God, your glory streams from the heavens above, filling the earth with the majesty of your name. People everywhere see your splendor. Join me in prayer. Dear God, we thank you for letting us gather here this morning. We thank you for an opportunity to fellowship with each other and to worship you. We thank you for another year with our family and our friends. We ask that you continue to watch over and bless our community and heal us. And help us to have that childlike faith. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. One of the coolest hymns in our hymnal that we don't utilize quite enough is the one we're getting ready to sing called Lift High the Cross. As you are standing, if you want to look in your hymnal, it's hymn 159. We will sing verses 1, 3, and 4. I'm going to have Peggy play through it first to kind of refresh your memory. We've done it before, but it's such a powerful hymn, I want you to sing it again. So let's stand as we sing hymn 159, Lift High the Cross. Together on the chorus.
Christians follow this triumphant song. As many of you know, football season started this week, and so reminded me of something that happened one time at a church I was serving. We had this guy in our church, his name was Guy, which I thought was the greatest name for a guy, was Guy. But Guy had a hard time hearing in church, and so oftentimes he just kind of sat there and slept in church, and I didn't think much about it because I knew he couldn't hear. Well, then we got this little system where it would put a hearing aid in your ear during service, and it was on an FM transmitter that would broadcast our service so that people with hard of hearing could hear. And Guy wore that, and for the first few Sundays he wore it, but he still kind of slept and wasn't, you know, too involved. Then one day I noticed that, man, he was awake the whole service. And he was just, you know, excited. He had an expression on his face where he'd get excited, he'd get down, he'd get excited, and he was all me. I was like, man, this is the most I've ever seen Guy active in church. Well, I thought it was a wonderful service, and so afterwards, you know, they just kind of put their FM transmitter on the seats and the pews, and he left, and I was going to clean up afterwards, and I picked up his FM transmitter. And somehow Guy had learned how to change the channel. And Guy was listening to the Mississippi State football game. I was like, I can't be mad. But I love it that, you know, here I thought he was listening and getting excited about everything I said, but he was actually listening to someone else. But whenever we go to the Lord in prayer, do you realize that God hears your voice? I mean, just let that sink in. The creator of creation pauses heaven to listen to what we're saying. How beautiful is that? He doesn't change a channel. He doesn't tune you out. He listens. And so we come to this time of prayer. I want you to imagine that scene of God telling the angels to shh, 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 shh. My child's about to talk to me. I want you to imagine God giving you his undivided attention. So as we go to the Lord in prayer, the altar rail is open. A couple of prayer concerns for us to be in prayer for. Leon Gibbons is in the hospital. He has an infection in his body. And so if you'll please keep Leon in your prayers. Also, this past week, I lost a really good friend. His name was Bill. If you'd keep Bill and his family in your prayers. His name is Bill Moore. And so just keep the Moore family in your prayers. The altar rail is open. Let us prepare our hearts to come to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, Lord, thank you for all that you are and all that you do. You have blessed our lives in so many ways, and we are so grateful. Lord, every breath we have is a gift from you. Every day is a gift. Every moment of our lives. Father, we are grateful for the grace we have received. We are grateful for Jesus Christ, for the cross that he gave. And Lord, as we sang this morning, may we, not only as Christians, but as a church, lift high the cross. May we never be ashamed of our Savior or the good news he brings to us. Father, we know that without you we are lost. We are sheep without a shepherd. But Father, you have searched us. You have sought after us even in our lostness. As your word says, even while we were yet still sinners, Christ died for us. Lord, we can never thank you enough for this. And Father, we want to lift up those on our prayer list, all those who are continuing to battle this awful virus that is in our community and our world. Father, for all those right now who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Father, it's at these times that the power of the resurrection is most felt. But Lord, it's hard. It's hard to lose someone you care about. So Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit, the great comforter, would wrap his loving arms around those who are hurting. And Father, I pray that as we worship you this day, that everything we say, everything we do, be done to glorify your holy name. And Lord, what a promise we have in Scripture, that as we draw near to you, you will draw near to us. So Father, we are here. May you be honored and glorified. May you be exalted. And may you draw near to your church. Father, we thank you. And we lift all these prayer concerns and all the ones in our hearts that we cannot mention. And we bring them before your throne. Lord, hear our prayers. And it's with this confidence that we now say our family prayer together that Jesus taught us to pray as we say as one. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all the
to give to God with our tithes and offerings. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly and gracious Father, as you have given us so much, we are grateful for the many ways you've touched our lives. Father, as we return these tithes and offerings unto you, let us do so with a cheerful heart, knowing that you love a cheerful giver. Lord, may these tithes and offerings be used to further your kingdom, for in Christ we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
it's time if I can have all our young kids come forward for Moments with Children. Well, guys, I want to tell you one of my favorite stories that Jesus told. It's about two people who went up to pray. One was a Pharisee who was the preachers of their day. They were the people who had all the answers and knew the Bible, and they knew all the good things they were supposed to do. They tried to follow the law as best as they could. And the tax collector was the mean people who took your money, and people didn't like them. And so Jesus said that they both went up to pray. And the Pharisee got up there to pray, and he got his position right. He's like, hands folded properly. Get them just equally like this. And he said, Dear Heavenly Father, you must be so proud of me. I am so good. I tithe. I read my Bible, I do my homework, I clean my room, I eat my vegetables. Lord, I thank you that I am not like these smelly kids. I am so grateful that I listened to my mom and dad. I'm so grateful that I take my baths and showers. I am so grateful that I listen and do what I'm told, unlike these little kids who never listen to you. Is that a good way to pray? No, no. And so, but he went on, he said, I thank you, Lord, that I am not like this tax collector. I give my money. I don't do bad things. I'm not like him. And then the Pharisee got up, was like, yep, good talk, God. And then the tax collector came. Now, how do you think, if that's how a righteous Pharisee prays, how do you think a tax collector is going to pray? But Jesus, what's that? Pretty good, yeah. Well, the tax collector, he came, and he just couldn't even get close. He just fell down. And he just looked up and beat his chest and said, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. In other words, saying, Lord, I know I'm not good. I'm sorry. I messed up. Please forgive me. And Jesus asked a question. Which one went home justified? What do you think? The tax collector. Very good, Cam. You see, sometimes we want to go and we think that God's impressed with how good we are and all this. Now, God wants us to be good. But part of the thing we need to realize is that when we come to God, we come with a humble spirit, and we come before him and say, God, I need you. God, help me to be humble before you. God, without you, I'm nothing. God, help me. And so we humble ourselves before God, and that's what he wants, okay? So when you go to prayer, don't go and tell God how good you are. Go and say, God, I love you. I need you. And God will help you then, okay? Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, thank you so much for these wonderful kids, and may your blessing be upon them, and may they always be humble before you. Father, bless them. May they always remember how much you love them and how much we love them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, y'all, come get your candy.
First of all, we have several visitors amongst us today, so before you leave today, make sure you go up and give a fist bump and welcome those people. I think we can all identify that in our daily walk with Christ, we fight battles. And the song you're about to hear is very powerful because it simply says, the battle belongs to you, Lord, and I'm going to see a victory because of what you're going to do. We're honored and blessed and very thankful to have Maggie Woodruff visit with us today and to sing. And Charity, we're thankful for you as well. They're going to come and I knew I better throw that in there or I was going to get in trouble. We're going to have them come and sing for us, Sea of Victory.
We have so many talented singers in this church. We are so blessed. If you have your scriptures, please turn to Matthew chapter 5. We'll look at verses 1 through 12. Now when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecute the prophets who were before you." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. All right, let me ask you a simple question. Who was the hardest teacher you've ever had? I tell you, I had a teacher when I was in college. I took a class in the Civil War, and I had a professor, and y'all, I'm absolutely certain he fought in the Civil War. He was an old man. He had long gray hair tied back in a ponytail, and he did not refer to it as the Civil War. He called it the War of Northern Aggression. And he had a gigantic book that he wrote that we went on this class, that we had to learn this class and read. And he, I mean, brilliant. He taught, like I said, he was actually there. But what made his class so hard was that you only got two grades in that class. You got a midterm and you had a final. And he didn't do true or false questions. He didn't do multiple choice questions. He didn't even do simple essay questions. What he would do is he would grab five terms from your lectures and from your readings and just give those terms, and you had to write everything you knew about that term. And of course, he didn't choose, you know, Grant or Lee. He chose some obscure general or some obscure battle that no one ever heard about. And his opinion was that C meant average. So if everybody in the class got a B, that meant that it was no longer average. So he told us up front, he said, about 80% of y'all are going to get a C. Some of y'all are going to get a B, some maybe might get an A, but the others of you will fail. Now, I loved learning in his class, but y'all, we never left his class feeling up. You know, we never left his class feeling smart. We always felt like, man, I'm the dumbest person around, and then we were also accused of being a Union loyalist. Now, I had another professor, very nice. Oh, I mean, he was just a nice guy. But the problem was, he didn't do anything in class. When it came time to take our test the week before, the day before, he would actually give us a study guide, which the study guide was actually the test. He would go over the study guide with us to make sure that we would know the answers to the test, and then he'd give us the test, and he'd allow us to use our notes, which was our study guide, which was the test. If you failed that class, you were just plain dumb, and there was no hope for you. But I say that because both of those, I look back, and I was like, wow, one, I learned a lot, but I can never live up to what I thought I was learning. Another one, I got a great grades, but I never learned a thing in it. And I wish there was a way that I could combine learning something, but at the same time, being able to live what I learned and accept it because I learned it. We're going to start today a series. We're going to focus on Jesus as a teacher. Now, that's where the early disciples began. We often skip over this. You know, the early disciples, when they first saw Jesus, they knew him as a rabbi, and they knew that he was a teacher, and they listened to what he taught. And when they listened to what he taught, and they watched his life, they realized he was much more than a teacher. He was their Savior, he was their Lord, he was their God. But it all started by listening to him as their rabbi, as their teacher. Now, I gotta be honest, we often skip over this. I think oftentimes we are like Christmas, Easter Christians. We go straight from the birth of Christ to the death and resurrection of Christ and then the return of Christ.
But we forget that in between the birth and the death and resurrection, Jesus said a whole bunch of stuff. And he lived a life. A lot of folks say, well, what would Jesus do? What does Jesus want from me? Well, he told us. He taught us how we're supposed to be living. But here's the problem. It's hard. It's really hard. If you've ever sat and actually read what Jesus taught and then try to live it out, it is difficult. Francis Chan once wrote an article entitled, "Would You Want Jesus as Your Pastor?" And basic response was, no, you wouldn't. He said, for example, the way that Jesus taught, oftentimes he purposely taught that you wouldn't get what he was saying. He would teach a parable. For example, one time he had a big crowd. He said, the kingdom of God is like this. Sower goes out and throws some seed. Some falls on the hard sidewalk. Some falls and some birds come and get it. Some seed falls and you think it's going good, but all of a sudden the weeds choke it out. But some seed, it falls on good ground and it grows up and brings a lot of fruit. If you have ears, hear it. Boom, done. And he walked away. And the disciples were like, Jesus, what was that about? What did that mean? And he's like, listen, I shouldn't have to explain this stuff to you because if you want to hear it, you'll hear it. So, I mean, I do the exact opposite. Even in my sermons, I even have a section called So What? So just in case you didn't get what I said, you get what I said. But Jesus wasn't like that. And then he didn't teach easy stuff. He taught hard. He taught for commitment. In a day when we are building stuff, everybody, you do you. You do what makes you happy. You do what's easy. You do what's convenient. You do everything. Jesus said, no, deny yourself. Pick up your cross, follow me. And he says, count the cost, because this is hard stuff. In fact, he went so far to say, be perfect, as my Father in heaven is perfect. Now, when we talk about the teachings of Jesus, we tend to gravitate towards ones we like, the prodigal son, you know, the good Samaritan, and all stories like that. But there is so much more. And that's why we're going to focus for the next few weeks on the Sermon on the Mount. And so, y'all, here's your homework. Over the next 2 months, I want you to read through Matthew chapter 5 through 7. And I want you to do it in all different types of translations. I want you to go through the NIV, the King James, the Passion, the Message, all of them, so that you get a grasp of what Jesus is saying. And if you think it's going to be easier than the law, it's hard. You know, Jesus said, I did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. And he doesn't just simply tell you all, he ups it. For example, the Old Testament said, do not commit adultery. You're like, I can do that. That's good. I haven't done that. But Jesus says, listen, if you even look at a woman with lust in your heart, you've already committed adultery in your heart. You're like, whoa, Jesus, that's hard. He said, do not commit a murder. You're like, I haven't killed anybody that no one knows about. But Jesus says, listen, if you have anger in your heart towards someone, you've already committed murder towards them. You're like, wow, how in the world am I supposed to live up to that? These are hard. And so how do we do that? How do we approach his teachings? Well, the first thing is this. We cannot, and I repeat, cannot disconnect the teachings of Jesus from the teacher. The teachings only make sense in light of the gospel. The people heard Jesus, and it was hard, but there was something about Jesus where they knew that they were loved, they knew that he was special, and they knew that when he talked, it came from God. And so they listened and said, this is hard stuff, but if it means I get to live like you, I want that, because I want to be like you. And as difficult as the teachings are, Jesus says, this is how you're really supposed to live. I love what he says in Matthew chapter 11. He says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. So when we look at these teachings, remember, Jesus says, I want to give you peace with this. Because the way you're living, you're not getting the rest you need. I want you to truly find your peace in God. and that comes through me. Second of all, we just simply can't dismiss them. I mean, it'd be easy if we could do that. So Jesus said, love your enemies. Yeah, but that's what he said. But what he really wants us to do is just be happy. Sometimes people look at the teaching of Jesus and they say, well, those are for super duper Christians. Those are for those who really want to be serious about their faith and they're fanatical. And so the whole loving your enemy stuff, that's just for those who are really serious about their faith. But we church-going Christians, we just do our own thing on Sunday. Some have gone so far to say that the teachings of Jesus are meant simply for the end times. That when Jesus returns, that's when we can live like this. But right now, we just can't. But the problem is, Jesus never said these things. So we have to live them. Jesus said, if you love me, obey my commandments. But the third thing is, we cannot turn this into a new form of law. John said the law came through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. We can't replace the Old Testament law with a New Testament law and say, we got to do this. If you do, you'll be miserable. In the book that Philip Yancey wrote called The Jesus I Never Knew, he told a story of Leoy Tolstoy. Y'all know The War and Peace? Let me show you this picture. Now, does that not just scream Christian joy? But he read the New Testament, and he wanted so bad to have perfect obedience for Jesus Christ that he took everything literally. So, example, when he read the story of the young rich ruler, he said, that means that Jesus wants me to sell away all my copyrights, give away all my stuff. And so he gave away basically everything. He made a list of rules on how he was supposed to live his life. He took a vow of chastity at least 16 times with his wife. He said, wife, you got to sleep in a separate room in a separate bed. But every time he did that, she would get pregnant and have a kid. And it said it was always his embarrassment when he had 16 kids that, you know, showed the whole world that he wasn't living in to his thing. But the thing is, he died miserable. His wife made a comment, said that he said he loved Jesus, but you would never know that because of the way he treated those closest to him and the misery. And he died penniless as a vagrant. Now, does that seem like Christian joy? No. I want you to compare this with another Russian man, Okay, I can't pronounce his name. But anyway, he was raised in the church, and admitted, I was raised in the church, but I was not a good Christian. I was a bad boy. And he grew up, and he did some bad stuff, ended up getting put in prison for 10 years. And while he was in prison, someone gave him a New Testament. He said that even though he'd been in church his whole life, he never actually read the Bible. He said when he read that, he fell in love with Jesus. And he started changing his life. He said he was still a mess, but everything he did came from this place of relationship. He said he wanted to do good by God because of how God had chosen him, how God had loved him. And he had such joy in his life and such peace because he wasn't simply trying to obey a bunch of rules. He was trying to walk with Jesus Christ. And I hope you see the difference in that. You see, it's not about becoming simply a better person. It's about becoming a new creation. And when you realize how spiritually bankrupt you are, you realize you can't live up to it, and you need someone who can, and you try to follow him and learn from him and be redeemed by him. And that's what Jesus does with this. He redeems us. He shows us. Let me explain it this way. One of my daughters a while back had a job, and she only worked there for about a week. But when she went there to this job, they hired her and stuck her in a position and didn't give her any lessons or teach her how to do it. They just said, hey, do this now, and left her there. And when she couldn't do it, they got mad at her and yelled at her. And you're like, what? You didn't teach me how and all this. Now compare that to another person who starts a job, and the person comes and says, now, you work here now, you represent our business, here's how I want you to do this. But I know this is hard, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to be by your side, I'm going to work with you through this. I'm going to show you how to do this. If you have any questions, I will be here to answer for you. If you mess up, I will forgive you, and we'll try to do better next time. But I'm going to work with you so much and help you live this out till you get to the point where it becomes second nature to you. Now, isn't that a lot better? And that's what Jesus does when it comes to life. He says, this is how I want you to live. And so we're going to start the series on the Sermon on the Mount, and we're going to learn what it means to walk as Jesus did, to show us how to live. And it's a beautiful way to live. And it all starts with this, by learning what it means to be blessed, okay? So, do you remember watching the movie The Princess Bride? Remember they were saying, you know, inconceivable, you know? And he kept saying, inconceivable. And finally, when the guy said, listen, you keep saying that word, I don't think you know what that word actually means. Well, you know what? One of the code words in the Christian church now is blessed. Oh, I'm so blessed. Oh, honey, I'm blessed, oh, you know? And we say blessed like we know what blessed means. But oftentimes, when we're talking about blessed, we mean, oh, my goodness, I got me a new car. God bless me. I got a new job. God bless me. Do y'all realize that's not what blessing means? Blessing doesn't mean you get what you want, and blessing does not mean you are always happy. In fact, oftentimes, those who have the most tend to be the most unhappy, and those who have the most tend to be the most unholy. You don't connect those two to being blessed. But when Jesus talked about blessed, he connected to words like meekness, persecution, weeping, mourning. I mean, think about that. It really takes a whole sermon to a different level. When you're doing your bedtime prayers to your kids and your kid says, dear Father, bless Mommy. Like, he's actually saying, Lord, make Mommy spiritually bankrupt. Make Mommy mourn for her sins. But Jesus redefines what this means. And where I'm going to go through these quick, but I want you to see how Jesus lays out these beatitudes. But they're actually wonderfully, because they're progressive. One leads to the next. And it really leads to a blessed life. So the first thing is this, is we recognize that we are spiritually bankrupt before God. Look at verse 3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. The poor in spirit, what that means is you come to God and you recognize I have nothing to bring. That all my spiritual gifts, all my goodness, all my deeds, they're like filthy rags before God. And you realize that, God, I come to you naked, poor, wretched, blind. I have nothing to give you. Because that's when God can start. Let me ask you this. How many of y'all have ever tried to help a kid with their homework? And one of the worst things when you're trying to help a kid with their homework is when the kid thinks they know more than what they know. And you sit there and say, okay, what you want to do is you want to carry the four. No, I've got this, Dad. I know how to do that. It's wrong. No, I know this. And you sit there, and all of a sudden, you're just like pulling your hair out, ready to give your kid away to the fire department or something. Because your kid is not at the point yet where they say, I don't know what I'm doing. Because they cannot receive your help until they get to the point where they say, I can't do this. We told a story about the Pharisee and the tax collector. One was spiritually bankrupt. One thought, I had enough money. But that's your starting point. You come and say, Lord, nothing in my hand I bring, but simply to thy cross I cling. And then that leads to when you realize how spiritually bankrupt you are and how your sins are, you mourn for those sins. And so that leads to verse 4. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Now, this does not mean simply mourning in general. I wish it did. But there are some folks who mourn and they never receive comfort. What he's talking about here is when you see your spiritual bankrupt, when you recognize the sins in your life, you start to mourn, not because you got caught, but because you know what your sins do to the heart of God. And you weep over those. Let me explain it this way. One of my daughters, Carrie, when she was, y'all, bless your heart if you're not a pastor's kids. I know, story she used. But one time, Carrie, we got her this Amazon Fire tablet, y'all. It was awesome. It was great. She could play games on it. It was wonderful. She could do this. And I was like, this is Amazon. It's safe and all that. But in order to buy games, I had to connect my Amazon account to it. And so she started playing games on this Amazon thing. And y'all know these games, they're free, but if you want to get little gifts or little things to go to the next level, they will charge you for it. Well, all of a sudden, we get a bill from Amazon, and we owe $800. And I'm like, no, someone stole our card. Someone broke in, and just because we did not spend $800 on Amazon on games, and we're like... And they said, they went through and they said, well, sir, did you own a Fire tablet? I'm like, my daughter does. And so long story short, I bring her out and say, Carrie, did you spend $800 on games? And she broke. And I'm like, Carrie, it's okay because they forgave the thing. They took the $800 off. We said that you were just a little kid and that you, you know, and were special and you didn't know. But she just broke down in tears. And I would say, it's okay. She's like, I'm so sorry, Dad. I'm sorry. And I'm like, it's okay. She goes, no, I'm sorry. And it wasn't that she got caught in trouble. She felt like she had disappointed me. And imagine when we go before God like that. God, I'm sorry I sinned. But God is full of compassion. Chuck Swindoll said that God loves the brokenhearted, the bent knee, and the wet eye. And the next thing is, this leads to, when you realize that, you submit your lives to God. Look next verse. Verse 5. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Now, that meek, that's a word. That word is actually, in the Greek, it's prios, and it means to bring strength under a control. And it means like this. It's a term that was used to break a horse. Have you ever saw horses out in the wild? Horses are like, and they just boom, 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 boom. And then some cowboy jumps up on that horse and just says, come here, boom, boom, and they grab him. And then they grab that horse, they put that bit in their mouth, and they're like, whoa, whoa, whoa. And they get to the point to where the horse can, you know, he goes, over here, whoa. They've broken the horse. Is the horse still strong? Yeah. But you know what? Now this horse is under the control of another. When it says, blessed are the meek, it means that we surrender our lives to God. We are under his control. And so when you realize that you're under his control, you submit your life to God, this leads to the next one, verse 6. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. You start to want what God wants. If you've emptied your life, you say, God, I have nothing to bring, and then you're mourning for your sins, and then you go to God and say, God, I surrender my life to you. You start to want what God wants. God, I want your will to be done in my life. I want the things you want, and fill me with those. And God says he will. And then this leads to changing your attitude. Look at the next one, verse 7. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. When God does this in my life, it starts to change how I look at other people's life. It's amazing when you realize spiritually bankrupt and in your mourning for your sins, how that gets rid of the pride in your life. I'll tell you all, one of the greatest things I ever had a chance to do is I got to go to an AA meeting. The church I was serving, we were starting a new chapter, and they said, why don't you come visit with us? I got there, and I saw this man get up there, and he said, oh, let me tell you all the bad stuff I've done. And he said one thing after that. I'm like, oh. But you know what? Nobody else in that room flinched. Nobody else judged. Because everybody else had been there before, too. And there was no condemnation. There was just grace and forgiveness. It's amazing how when you receive mercy, you give that mercy. And when you start to live like that, it starts to change inside. Look next verse, verse 8. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. It starts to change who you literally are. Your heart becomes more sincere. You start to pursue God and seek after him. And this leads to the next one, verse 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. It's amazing when God does that in your life, the anger starts to go, and all of a sudden, you're not trying to get in between stuff, you're trying to bring people together. You've received love, you want to give love, you want others to love each other. It's amazing how that works. And real quick, when you do that, not everybody's going to like it. And so what happens? Verse 10. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Not everybody's going to love it, but it's okay. But I want you to see what you get. When you start to live this life and God starts to do this in your heart, first of all, you're comforted. Second of all, you see God. But then you get the kingdom of heaven. What more do you want? And this all enables you to live from a different point, to live as a kingdom follower of Jesus Christ, to where you become a new creation and you live out and have that blessed life. But here's the thing, it starts with this wonderful beginning point. Lord, I have nothing to bring to you. I'm empty. And so as we begin to take communion this day, I want you to be reminded of this, that we can't go to God and brag about how good we are. We can't go and say, God, you should die for me because I've earned this. But we come before God, broken, humble, as a sinner. But yet he gives everything to us. So let's prepare for this. Christ the Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another as we say together, Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night on which he gave himself up for us, he broke bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith together. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and all these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Let us now prepare to take the bread, the body of Christ broken for us. blood of Christ given for us. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, Lord, how great and how wonderful is your love for us. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful gift of Jesus Christ, that while we were yet still sinners, Christ died for us, and this proves your love towards us. Father, may we never take for granted the gift that you've given to us. May we always live with a grateful heart for our Savior, our Lord, our King, Jesus Christ. And as we have lived for him, may we always go forth and serve him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What a great God we serve. Let's bow our heads, we'd be dismissed. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, Lord, as we go forth, may we go forth as redeemed children of your kingdom. May we go forth knowing that we are loved by you. And Father, may we go forth and share this love with others. Father, watch over us and keep us safe now and forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.